Welcome back to Paul's Tech News. Suddenly, it's mid-November, and just as we thought the PC hardware space had gone dormant for the winter, at least until CES, quite unexpectedly, Valve bursted forth with a torrent of announcements, generating what was effectively an atmospheric river of tech news, similar to the one currently drenching the West Coast. But we won't let a little November rain keep us from holding a candle to the Steam Machine, Steam Controller, and Steam Frame VR headset. And also of note, GamersNexus Steve appears to be on the run from the feds, and despite our collective shock and dismay, PC hardware, specifically RAM and now SSDs as well, is continuing to go up in price, with the forecast for the future looking gloomy. So grab your umbrellas, it's time for Tech News. Excellent. Today's video is brought to you by Thermaltake's View 600 TG Full Tower Chassis, featuring four tempered glass panels that provide an unobstructive view of your PC and support for massive 420mm radiators for AIO or custom cooling. Available in five distinct and unique colorways, including Future Dusk, the View 600 TG also supports hidden connector and E-ATX motherboards, and includes an anti-sag GPU bracket and rotatable PCIe slots, as well as easily removable ventilation panels and plenty of room for cable management and added storage. There's an optional 6-inch LCD add-on too. For more on the View 600 TG from Thermaltake, click the sponsor link in the video description. 'Twas the morning of Wednesday, November 12th, when Valve's embargo lifted and their new lineup of hardware was revealed via Valve's official video and a slew of media outlets who had previously visited Valve headquarters in Bellevue, Washington. There's a new Steam controller, a VR headset called the Steam Frame, and at last, the official Steam Machine, a cute little black box-shaped mini PC that's already been dubbed the GameCube. All three launch in early 2026 and are designed to work with Linux-based SteamOS. So let's start with the Steam Machine and implications for SteamOS. Hardware-wise, it's powered by a semi-custom AMD CPU with 6 Zen 4 cores running at up to 4.8 GHz and an AMD RDNA 3 GPU with 28 compute units and 8 GB of dedicated DDR6 VRAM, which should reportedly perform about the same as a slightly overclocked Radeon 7600M, and that puts it in the same range as about an NVIDIA RTX 2070 or Radeon RX 6600 if you're comparing to desktop performance. But Valve said their goal was to give it enough performance to play every game on Steam at 4K 60 when you do some sort of upscaling like FSR. It's a pretty big asterisk on the end there. No benchmarks were allowed to verify this yet though, but to finish off the specs, there's 16GB of DDR5 RAM, which is upgradable according to Digital Foundry, as there are two SODIMM slots internally, though they require disassembly to access. As you'll probably notice from shots of the Steam Machine without its housing, everything is quite packed in with a massive combined heatsink for the CPU, GPU, and memory chips, as well as a single axial fan. For storage, there's an internal M.2 slot that's a bit easier to access, and it can fit 2230 or 2280 sized SSDs. By default, there will be 512GB and 2TB versions. There's also a micro SD slot for added storage or swapping between the Steam Machine and Steam Deck. It has a clean and minimalist black design made to fit into home theater and living room setups, with a programmable LED strip across the front above two USB ports and the micro SD card slot. On the back, there's power, RJ45, two more USB-A and one USB-C port, and for video outs, there's one DisplayPort 1.4 and one HDMI 2.0 port that also supports some HDMI 2.1 features like HDR and FreeSync. The front panel is held on by magnets so it can be removed for dusting, and Valve showed off customized and 3D printed panels, as well as a cool e-ink demo display that won't be up for sale, but they just made to kind of show off the possibilities. Fan and media responses to Valve's Steam Machine announcement seem quite positive overall, with the only notable critiques I've heard being that 8GB of VRAM might be a bit of a concerning limitation for the GPU, and that the cooling needs some independent testing given the box's apparent lack of ventilation. Embargo Day content included extensive interviews with Valve hardware engineers though, which were quite in-depth and much appreciated, and they say the cooling solution is up to the task. Just don't put it on a carpet. The massive questions that remain are, when in early 2026 will it actually launch, and what will the price be? Valve may not even know the answer to that yet, given the big upward swings recently for RAM and SSD prices, but since they did say it's priced more like an entry-level PC than a console, speculators are estimating between $600 and $1,000. Before we cover the controller and VR headset, I wanted to talk about the glue holding all Valve's new hardware together, which is SteamOS, the Arch Linux-based operating system whose current version 3.0 launched alongside the Steam Deck back in 2022. While no major developments for SteamOS were announced alongside the new hardware, when the Steam Machine and Steam Frame launch, they will grow the SteamOS user base and provide yet another alternative to gaming on Windows. Many lament the fact that PC gaming is so often inherently tied to the Windows OS, as Windows 11 in particular has provided much frustration due to hardware upgrade requirements, built-in tracking and ads, and increasingly heavy-handed methods of roping users into using a Microsoft account. A future where SteamOS exists as an open-source general-purpose operating system alternative to Windows sounds great, but there's a lot of development work needed to get there, and that's why an expanded user base is good news, because it's not just Valve's development of SteamOS that needs to progress, we also need AAA game developers and major publishers to see the value of catering to SteamOS users so issues like kernel-level anti-cheat systems can be resolved, and major titles like Call of Duty Black Ops 7 and Battlefield 6 don't get blocked from the platform. But let's finish off the hardware. The Steam Controller, V2 I might add, with light contempt as an OG Steam Controller owner, can be easily summed up as a Steam Deck without the screen. There are some cool upgrades though, like the Steam Controller Puck that serves as both a 2.4 GHz receiver and a magnetic mini charging dock. The Steam Machine, by the way, has the same 2.4 GHz receiver built in. And the Steam Controller can also connect via Bluetooth or wired USB. The most distinguishing feature is probably the dual touchpads underneath the thumbstick, which each have a haptic feedback motor, and there are also dual haptic motors in the grips for force feedback. The remaining button layout is pretty familiar, and there are four programmable grip buttons on the controller's bottom too. The thumbsticks also use magnetic sensors rather than mechanical ones, which in theory should prevent stick drift. And finally, there's the Steam Frame, a VR headset that is also a mini PC that can run SteamOS standalone thanks to the Qualcomm Snapdragon 8 Gen 3 ARM processor that powers it. More lightweight games will be able to run locally, but whether you're doing that or streaming games from a Steam machine, the Steam Frame is completely wireless, a big step forward for immersive VR experiences. Specs-wise, the Steam Frame has dual 2160x2160 pancake lens screens with 110-degree field of view, and weighs just 435 grams, with a battery pack on the back of the head strap for balance. It also has 16 gigabytes of RAM and will ship with either 256 gigabytes or 1 terabyte of built-in storage, as well as a micro SD card slot. There are 4 cameras built into the headset that track your surroundings to detect your movement, aka inside-out tracking that doesn't require external devices, and the included USB adapter establishes a dedicated 6 GHz connection between the headset and gaming PC. There's still a lot of data to transmit wirelessly though, so Valve also developed a method they call foveated streaming that uses eye tracking on the headset to stream the part of the image you're looking at a higher quality while the surrounding image has the quality lowered to optimize the bitrate. That's actually pretty cool, and it works with all games since it only optimizes each frame after it's rendered. My big question, if you hadn't guessed, was can you wear the Steam Frame with glasses? And per Linus, the answer is yes. There's a spacer gasket for that, which also helps if you have long eyelashes. But more ideally, they're working on prescription lenses, which will be available sometime after launch, though we don't know when that will be, and neither do we know what any of this will cost. Still, in a year when most of the exciting PC hardware launches were either canceled or delayed, Valve's hardware announcements were refreshingly exciting. Speaking of refreshing excitement, those words both describe what's in my tech briefs. One thing that Valve didn't announce this week was Half-Life 3, but they did announce 3 new pieces of hardware. Half-Life 3, you can see that this was obviously a signal that the long-denied sequel must finally be upon us. At least that seems to be the vibe over on Reddit, where a credible Half-Life data miner named Tyler McVicker has been quoted saying that the wait will soon be over, and these hardware announcements were just an opening act before the main event, which will still be taking place sometime in 2025. Half-Life 3 is a Steam Machine launch title, preloaded even perhaps, would likely induce mass hysteria and be the catalyst for some world-ending apocalypse, but that would still make 2026 an improvement on 2025. Speaking of the end of the world, if we are hurtling towards that, I hope GamersNexus Steve can publish the rest of his AI investigation series first, which was escalated significantly on Tuesday as he revealed that his journalistic endeavors in the world of AI surveillance have earned him a visit from the United States Secret Service Cybercrime and Financial Fraud Division, asking him about one of the businesses he was investigating, which he did not disclose. Steve is justifiably frustrated, as am I, with goings on in the tech world, specifically businesses like Nvidia, whose goals seem to have broadened threateningly beyond just making GPUs for video games like they did in the good old days, to drastically ramping up government lobbying efforts and collaborating with corpos like Palantir, who want to build out an AI-powered surveillance state, which is a shitty thing that sucks. It's a good video if you haven't watched it yet, albeit disturbing, but the main point I want to make here is that Steve is healthy and of sound mind, and he is definitely not suicidal. Moving over to slightly less disturbing news, now that most DDR5 and even DDR4 memory prices have at least doubled, it's time for storage prices to skyrocket too. TrendForce saying NAND giants cut output doesn't sound great either, but that's a bit of a misleading headline. They're cutting TLC NAND production so they can focus more on QLC production, because 4 bits per cell is more than 3, and the AI giants who are being routinely filleted by NAND and RAM giants, which is either a disturbing or arousing mental image, your choice, but the AI giants demand capacity, and hence QLC better. SanDisk has upped flash prices by 50%, and Samsung might do 20 or 30% hike in 2026, depends how they're feeling. But overall, PC prices are likely to see adjustments soon too, per Asus, as even pre-builts and proprietary systems feel the squeeze. Your only hope might be to win a computer for free in a giveaway. Hey, speaking of winning a computer for free in a giveaway, I just did one of those in October, and I have another one coming up next week, and a third in the first week of December. Hooray! And what timing? Here's an article on Cooler Master's new QUBE 540 case, which is just starting to go up for sale in some areas with a pretty affordable price, at least as reported in Europe, just 64 euros. I will be using this case for the December build, and I'm pretty excited to check it out since it has a unique design and the potential for 3D printed accessories. I always love cases with handles too. So practical. So just a reminder to subscribe if you haven't, so you can check out those builds and enter the giveaways when they go up. And these will all be helping to support the Awesome Hardware 2025 Extra Life charity stream that I'll be doing with Bitwit Kyle on Saturday, December 6th. Hope to see you there. But there you have it, guys. Tech news for the week, and if you liked it, click that like button or leave me a comment down below. While you're down there, all of the articles I talked about today are linked in the video's description if you're interested, and you can check out my store at paulshardware.net for high-quality merchandise, t-shirts, hoodies, beer sets, and more. Subscribing to my channel is always a good call, too. Thanks again, everyone, and we'll see you next week.